what's going on behind his disguise. Nobody knows where Buster goes. You steal your woman out from under your nose. Does anyone know the way? Did we hear someone say?
We just haven't got a clue what to do.
Does anyone know the way? There's got to be a way. They're running about. Don't know if they'll ever be able to block Buster out. He's gotta be caught. He's gotta be taught. Cause he is more evil than anyone here ever thought. Does anyone know the way? Did we hear someone say?
We just haven't got a...
Does anyone know the way? There's got to be a way.
And in fact, when we were making it, I called it Barry on Lyndon, which maybe I could have called it Barry on Lyndon, but Kubrick by Candlelight stuck. And, you know, there was no point making a film about Stanley Kubrick and not putting his name in the title. I think that's good marketing. I think that would be cool. So, yeah, that's kind of how the genesis. And then I wrote the script, and I was very lucky to then win some money to make the film in Ireland, and it was in the town or the county where my mum and dad are from, which was coincidental. I didn't win it because of that, but it meant I could call upon all my family to be in it behind the scenes. Also, you know, bedrooms, all kinds of favors were called, and actually, you know, the locations in it, which is obviously my day job, so you'd hope that was going to be a good production design. But they were all in a very small circle. And of course, the film is set in Waterford, where most of Barry Lyndon was filmed before they got kicked out. But the stipulation of the award was that we had to film it in County Offaly, which is in the middle of the Republic of Ireland. So the opening scene of the film, which you'll see later on, to all intents and purposes, is set in Waterford, where they shot it. But our visual effects guy Paddy Eason put in the famous mountain that's in Waterford into our field in Tullamore, County Offaly, and you know, it's, even for a short film, it's pretty impressive visual effects. So that's how we filmed it, you know, in the middle of December, which wasn't the best idea, but very short days, very cold. And in a bizarre way, our kind of experience of filming it, as you know, I'm obviously born in London, but I've got Irish parents. But us kind of going to Ireland to film in a strange way was kind of a micro version of the story of the filming of Barry Lyndon in a strange way. It was kind of, I've obviously spent many years on it, but Lynception we ended up calling it. So it's about the behind the scenes of our film was just as exciting as and crazy as the behind the scenes that I'm filming of the behind the scenes. There's met multiple levels, but yeah, Lynception may have worked as a kind of it was a marketing title that I came up with. but edited it, and we had great music, and then great actors, obviously. So, and we went big. That was the kind of the remit, apart from making a good film, was how do we make a short film with not much money look like a feature film, and using all of the tricks of the trade that we know, which is, you know, locations and production design can really expand your world beyond the usual short films, which, you know, admittedly, they work with what they got, which is, you know, kitchen sink and, you know, the living room. And so there's nothing against those films, but I wanted to push the limits of what's conceivable on not much money. We had horses, we had classic cars, we had, you know, multiple locations, extras, costumes, so we went, you know, we had 70s, we were set in the 70s, but we were also set in the 1770s, and so everything you would tell your students not to do We did. So, and that was, you know, that was kind of our mission statement was, you know, go big or go home. And I think it was successful in production value wise. It's kind of, it feels like a big movie, hopefully. But yeah, not without its casualties, financial, spiritual, and no physical injuries. But that's filmmaking generally. So we learned a lot. Surprisingly, I've been in the film industry a long time, but we learned probably more about filmmaking that weekend and also through the editing than we had in all those years before, bizarrely. So So that's kind of short intro to the film, I suppose, or a long intro.
I have already a couple of questions. Just to add, first question is, if it's not a secret, if you can share with us what was the budget of the film. And second question, maybe tell it a bit more how you were recreating the kind of, you know, the locations, the costumes, and like, how did you know how it all looked like on Kubrick's set?
Yeah, I mean, luckily, and you guys will have, you know, seen it in your preparation for the film festival, luckily there's an awful lot of amazing behind the scenes material about Kubrick and all of his films. And despite him being mysteriously quiet about his work and not doing many interviews, there is, you know, between Taschen books and the archive, obviously, which exists in London, there's an amazing resource of imagery and notes and stories. And so so visually it was all that kind of research that, you know, but there's obviously a lot of pictures of them filming Barry Lyndon. There was always a key picture, and I went to the Stanley Kubrick exhibition, which was in London a few years ago, but I went to it in Poland quite a while ago, six seven years ago. And there was a key picture, which I haven't seen anywhere else, which is of the lead actress in a caravan, a very small caravan, and the curtains look like the Shining carpet. So I'm sure it wasn't deliberate, you know, like it, but it just, that's the era that they were in. The curtains looked geometrical and strange and bright orange. I'll try and find the picture and send it to you guys. But it and I always, that kept in my head. And of course then I went a step further and made the curtains in our caravan for Shining carpet anyway. So but yeah, budget wise I mean, I tried to keep it small, but you know, things cost. I think I'm still paying for it now, strangely. There's still costs. It's unbelievable. Still costs, like website costs, and you know, it's gradually fading out, the cost of it. We got €8,000 from Film Offaly, which was the award that I won. Then we raised, we did a Kickstarter, and there was loads of people that put everything from £10 to one person gave us £2,001, which was amazing. And we're very grateful to Georgette for that. And then so this is kind of unusual, I suppose, and film students won't have this opportunity just yet, but because we had worked in the industry, we are some of the people that we've worked with in the past, like suppliers and equipment people and Ari Rental and things like that, MBS, who do lights for Pinewood. But Vinny, the producer, begged, didn't steal, but borrowed, you know, all of those guys to either give us money, which is fantastic, and their names are all at the end of the film, or equipment, which is obviously is you know, soft money or hard money, really, because so we got an Arri Alexa for free, and we got lenses for free, and we had to hire an 18-ton truck to drive from the UK to Ireland with all of our equipment. So we were a big show on a small budget. What the final budget was, I don't know, and I don't want to know now. But it you know, it crept up, because we paid, you know, we tried to pay the crew. Extras got food and they got petrol and all, you know, like as much as we could with the size that we were at. You know, my family were in it and, you know, helping. And so everyone was very gracious. I went on national radio in Ireland, and then got people to come down with their beautiful classic cars, and you know, extras locally wanted to be involved because it was kind of interesting and fun. And so, you know, a lot of people gave their time, as they often do with short films. And but yeah, so it's probably, you know, it's a bigger budget than most short films can go with, but a lot of our budget, and then obviously on top of all of that, me and Vinny put our own money in, which, you know, don't ever do that. But then also you have to at some point, because there's no one less invested in your short film than yourself, you know, in, so you've either got to put up or shut up, really. So it was, I would say it's a bigger budget than most students could possibly get into, but a lot of it was hustling equipment and people, costumes, cars, you know, hotel deals. I mean, there's a lot that goes into any short film, and what we know about feature films is the same. Even a feature film with $200 million budget is hustling every single penny. So all of it is a hustle, from a tiny short film to the biggest films in history. Everyone's looking for a deal, looking to get something for free, or looking for, you know, so, but, you know, it's, so that's, without telling you the real number, because I don't want
okay.
to,
that's okay.
It got big because, you know, we went big, I suppose, but a lot of the good stuff in our film, locations like the castles and, you know, pubs and churches, fields, hills, that's all for free, because if you're clever, you can get that stuff, and people are happy to open up if you're nice and they feel safe with you, then you can get that good stuff, you know, extras, as long as you feed them and, you know, pay for their bus fares and don't treat them badly and look after them. You know, these are kind of all things that you kind of forget on big films, because you can pay everyone, but which doesn't mean you can be nasty to them, but you get away with a lot more when you're paying people money. So a lot of the good value in it is was free, because, you know, apart from building a set, if you go out to a castle, you're getting something amazing quality on screen, basically. And then you add a great DOP and great actors. And then I actually, you know, I would guess I come quite far down the line in, you know, in making it look amazing, I suppose, in that sense. It's all the stuff in front of the camera that makes it look, makes any film, you know, no one, bizarrely, given the subject matter, no one cares what's behind the camera. And that's kind of what I was always interested in, is, you have, you know, like Barry Lyndon's a good example, and it's really the prime example. It's one of the most beautiful films ever made, and you could freeze frame it, and every shot is a portrait you could put on the wall. But I know behind the scenes, behind that camera, are people eating bacon sandwiches, scratching their ass, smoking cigarettes constantly, toilets falling over, all of, you know, like really brutal, dirty work. And then all of a sudden the camera switches on, and then everything focused in front is this amazing image that's captured. So I was always fascinated by that, because I'm behind the scenes all the time, and I know it's kind of rough and ready and dirty and you know, but also all of that then just fades away literally when you put the frame, and then it's, you know, Ryan O'Neill walking through a lovely room, and all of a sudden it's the most beautiful film in the world. So that, my film's kind of a version of that concept, in the sense mine's all about toilet. There's a lot of toilet humor in my film, and that's my sense of humor, but also it's very deliberate, because it's my kind of, my dichotomy of beauty and the beast behind the screen, which is people running in and out of hotel rooms and blocked toilets and talking about food. All film crews talk about food constantly. All they talk about is, what's for breakfast? Breakfast was terrible. What's for lunch? Let's not go here for lunch. Let's go somewhere else. What's for dinner? Where are we going tonight? Endless. It's endless about food. So there's a bit of eating and drinking in my film, and they, you know, it's all about the stuff that you never see, that doesn't matter, but its existence makes that final shot, you know, one of the most beautiful films ever made. So even though I wasn't there behind the scenes on Barry Lyndon, I know it will have been chaos, mud everywhere, and, you know, cars stuck in mud. And I know, yeah, I actually know that one of their toilets fell over in the field, and, you know, like all of that kind of brutal craziness. But none of it matters when, and all the arguments that happen, and, you know, arguments about money and all of that stuff, at the end of the day, when the film hits the cinema, all of it gets forgotten. So unless you've got a very serious personal beef, and then you'll remember it forever. And that doesn't happen in the film industry. There's no egos or at all. It's a lot kind of intro to how we try to make it as big as possible, basically.
Can I ask you, so you were not just a director, you were the writer as well. Can you tell a little bit more about how you were like writing and researching process to come to the script you have? And another question I had was, at what stage did you and how did you get Brian Cox on to be your narrator in the film, and how he was involved? It would be interesting to hear.
So I wrote it quite quickly, I think. And I remember I wrote it in Costa Coffee in Piccadilly Circus, which was my unofficial location office. So when I was scouting, and I can't remember what film I was working on then, but the other obsession with film crew people is toilets. And so as a location scout, you have to know where all of the toilets are in London or wherever you are, because you've got nowhere to go. So I used to base myself in a Costa Coffee in the basement, so they wouldn't go near you, and it was fine. So I wrote the script whilst I was working, obviously. So as I said at the beginning, I kind of originally had kind of simplified the structure of Barry Lyndon, and then took those kind of archetypal characters of Leonard Rossiter's character, and it eventually didn't become as clean cut as that. But yeah, I think I wrote it relatively quickly. And I think the reason was because I think we wanted to enter this competition, and there was a deadline coming. And as everyone knows, there's nothing better than the deadline. So I think it was a relatively quick process. And of course, within the script, I started to naturally put Kubrick references in, you know, because why wouldn't you? And then, as you now, some of you will have seen it and some of you will see it later, now there's about 90 Kubrick references, which is a bit much for 18 minutes, but it was good fun. But some of them are in the script and some of them are structural, some of them are music cues, some of them are VFX things that we put in. But yeah, there is a list of about 90. And in fact, I got an email from someone last year who watched the film online and then found 130. So I'm not sure where he got the extra ones from, but that's the power of Kubrick. There was stuff in there that I didn't even think were there. So yeah, it was a relatively short writing process. Once I won the competition, you know, we worked with Phil Moffley on the script then. So there were a few changes, a few things we added, and then a few things then you take out naturally because you realize they're too expensive to shoot. There was a fantastic scene that I'd written, which would have been good, but it was very hard for us to film, which would have been set in a kind of Romeo and Juliet window sequence where Paul, our lead character, is trying to wake up Amy, who's in this hotel, which we probably would have used the castle that we filmed in. And he throws a stone at the window and Kubrick pops his head out. And Kubrick then talks to Paul and says, no, she's a couple of windows down. And it was quite fun, but it was proper night shoot and windows. And so before we got into kind of pre-production, I sort of binned that scene, unfortunately, but it would have been very good. It would have been fun. And then that scene in some ways became the scene you'll see later that's set in the big tree. So it's kind of a little, I suppose, their first date. It's kind of it kind of amalgamated into that. So yeah, it was a relatively kind of short script process, but then you're always rewriting and trying to put gags in and adding the Kubrick references, because then that became a kind of benchmark of the film. And then you rewrite it all over again when you're in the edit, because then you've got to figure out the performances and swap scenes around. But we were quite lean, because you have to be, like, there's no scenes cut out of our film in the edit. We cut scenes out before, which I think was economical. And yeah, so there's only kind of the odd line and bits and pieces that we chucked out, but we were very lean and we shot quickly, which I regret in some ways, because a comedy is all about the performances. So I would have loved to have spent longer with the actors on each scene, but realistically, you've got to go and you've got to finish Make Your Day every day, because we tried to shoot a lot in a very short amount of time. So yeah, you're constantly writing the film until the moment you put it out to the world, basically. And I don't think that's any different from any filmmaker. They all say that, and that's very true. It's a constant rewriting process. And Brian Cox, well, not a kind of a long story, but I had a long list, and I really wanted an Irish narrator because I felt appropriate. And so I had a long list, and I started emailing people during our editing process. So we'd finished filming, and then we had done a tiny bit follow-up at Shepperton Studios, believe it or not. We did a kind of a day's reshoot, or added some stuff to our big montage in the middle, which was we weren't able to fill when we'd done our original filming. And I had a long list of names, and I really wanted someone like Colin Farrell or Brendan Gleeson, and in the end, through a friend of a friend who was Liam Neeson's assistant, we got very close to Liam Neeson. And so that was our narrator. And then he went off to do a film, which he does quite frequently, in the Arctic or somewhere in Canada, where he's driving through ice constantly. I think he's made about 10 of those since. But and then we lost him, in the sense that he, you know, we were at one point prepared to go to him to record it. But it kind of, yeah, it faded away. And then I started expanding the list. And then I emailed Brian Cox, voice agent rather than real agent, so that was the key to that, and he said yes straight away. And then he said, can we do it tomorrow? And I was like, okay, this is quick. So we had to get a studio in Soho booked, and we had the guy who doing the editing had a friend, so it was kind of set up. And the reason was, he was unable to work because he was locked into a show that hadn't started filming yet, but he couldn't do any other jobs. So he was doing nothing in London. And he was, the week after, he went off to New York to start filming a pilot of Succession. And I think a week later, we wouldn't have got Brian Cox, or certainly a year later, we wouldn't have got Brian Cox. So Succession helped us, because they were in a kind of development loop on the pilot. So he couldn't do anything else, just in case it started filming. So he managed to squeeze our one in for a very, very reasonable fee, really reasonable. But I imagine now would not be a very reasonable fee, if at all. So we were lucky, because in a bizarre way, I'm a great fan of Brian Cox and all of his work, but he hadn't, Succession obviously blasted him back into the limelight about a year later. So I would love to say it was all strategically planned by a casting director that we got Brian Cox when we did, but it was pure luck. And the reason was Succession, because he couldn't do anything else. So we were lucky, and, you know, I've been using his name ever since. Now, we did have a scene in the original script. There was a scene where there's a love scene in our film, and without spoiling it, but some of you will have seen it, it kind of pans to show someone standing in the room. And the original idea was that the narrator was narrating the love scene, and then we would pan across, and in the corner of the room would be Liam Neeson or Brian Cox. In the end, that would never, it wouldn't have worked. So we had a different gag in the film, but it's kind of there. The gag is there. But that was the original idea, that the narrator would be standing in the room awkwardly looking at Paul and Mary making out. But yeah, Brian was lovely, and he came and did, you know, he's a big fan of Barry Lyndon, big fan of Kubrick. And he was really funny, and yeah, got it completely, and yeah, really enjoyed the film without his narration on it. And then yeah, he was quick and yeah, brilliant. But yeah, so we were very lucky to get him prior to his kind of renaissance, and rightly deserved renaissance, I think.
Really great. That's really great. I wanted
so
to.
It's all luck. Filmmaking is all luck.
Yeah,
as we know.
Just minding our time before we move to the next topic, I was wondering if Mikhail or Janet have any questions about the film we were talking about, because then we will talk about David's professional experience on other productions. So, if you want to ask something now.
Yes, if I may. Yeah, David, it's when you're actually looking at locations, if you're working somewhere where the locations are iconic, how do you work with those locations without them looking cheesy and postcardish?
What do you mean in my day job version?
As any job, really, from you looking at a location.
Well, yeah. I mean, it's strange. I've been lucky in the last 10 years to start going abroad. So that's good fun. And that's where I am now. But before that, I was a location scout in London, you know, which is, you know, where the film studios generally are. I know it's spreading, which is good. And I worked on American films. And you can pretty much bet your bottom dollar, which is what we were working for, that they would always put a scene in front of Tower Bridge or and Piccadilly Circus. I mean, maybe Piccadilly Circus, but Tower Bridge virtually scouted every film I ever did for about 8 years. So I don't think there is a way to avoid it. But then I suppose what you have to remember, I suppose, is for the audience that, you know, that some of these films are playing to, it is exotic and not cheesy, I suppose, isn't it? I suppose when you become familiar yourself, you kind of become bored of it. And you know, some directors then take a place and put a spin on it anyway. Mm-hmm. That's the magic of filming and different filmmakers' viewpoint or cinematographers. Yeah. But yeah, so for a long time, I did get sick of seeing in my list of locations to find Tower Bridge. And it kind of, well, yeah, it was basically Tower Bridge was, but you know, and then obviously London specifically then has places that lots of film crews go to because they're either easy or accessible. And so the other one I would say, which actually I think has become, for me anyway, not cheesy, but overused, was Greenwich Naval College, which if you don't know it, Google it. And then you'll have seen it in almost every film, every period film in the last 15 years. And I worked on Pirates of the Caribbean 4, which had a big sequence in London at the beginning. And the designer at the beginning of my job said, do not show me Greenwich Naval College. I do not want to see it. So I was like, okay. So I went around the country looking for alternatives to London for that big action sequence. 6 months later, we took over Greenwich Naval College, and we were one of the biggest film shoots ever at Greenwich Naval College. And it's in the film, and, you know, most people don't care. But I saw it and I was like, oh, my God, there's another movie at Greenwich Naval College. And the reason being is it's obviously very beautiful, but it's controllable and it's got streets that are closed off so there's no cars and, you know, and the people that look after it are very film friendly. And so, those are... So I suppose it's the answer is sometimes you can't, because that's what they want. You know, iconic London imagery or iconic UK imagery is iconic because of what it is. But yeah, hopefully you get filmmakers that want to take a side angle on something and go deep and go deep in the UK, go further. And I've been scouting in Manchester, Liverpool, Glasgow. I haven't scouted Morecambe, but I know someone who has, and I can tell you later.
How about Blackpool?
Pardon?
How about Blackpool?
I have scouted Blackpool, and I worked on a film called Miss Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children. Mm-hmm. And my main job on that was finding the house. So this is a good example of, so we kind of moved into my day job, but it's a good story. That the main house was obviously a big part of that movie, and it was on the poster. And we struggled to find it. So I went around the UK looking for peculiar houses, and Tim Burton didn't like it, and it wasn't quirky enough. And then the writer of the book had used a house in Antwerp as a kind of inspiration, or it found its way online to being what people assumed was the house. So I convinced the producers to let me go to Antwerp to look for that house, the real house that they had used, which was then we found it was completely wrecked and abandoned. But then I thought, I guess Antwerp or this area might have more of these kind of houses. So I hooked up with a friend of mine, Annabelle, and we went driving around Antwerp and the environs of that area, and then stumbled across a house called Torrenhof. And as I came around the corner and looked at the house, I went, this is probably it, which doesn't happen very often because that's arrogant. But and then took the pictures and brought them back. And Tim Burton looked at the picture on a board and he went, you knew this was it, didn't you? And I was like, and I said, this is true. And this is terrible. I said, it's very Burton-esque, Tim. And that was it. The film needed a house that I think in the book is in Wales or somewhere like that. But we ended up in the outskirts of Antwerp for what looks like a very peculiar English house. But the reason it's peculiar is because it's not. It's in a completely different country. So that's an example of pushing the look is to the limits, and pushing the research. Now, had I not found that house, I suspect the designer probably would have built a house for Tim somewhere. We would have found a hill or a garden, and he would have built an entire house. But there you go. Luckily, we found the house. And as all film crew, all filming and location stuff is complete nonsense, we found the house, met the people, and they were just about to sell the house at auction. And the production company very close to buying the house at auction because it was so perfect. But in the end, they went to the auction, waited for the hammer to fall, and then went over to the person who just bought this amazing house that needed a lot of work and said, hello, congratulations on buying this new house. By the way, we'd like to film in it in a few months' time with Tim Burton and Ava Green and 40 kids and 200 crew. Luckily, that person said yes, because I've never been back, but I hope that the money we paid helped do the house up. So it just shows you, even when you find the most perfect spot, there's always trouble. So that was kind of a long answer to iconic locations and how, sometimes they are, and sometimes you've got to push for the extraordinary, I suppose.
Thank you
for the question, Janet. I saw that Mikhail had a question as well. Is it about the film or?
Yes, it is about the film. Okay. First, David, thank you for sharing the Antwerp story. I'm from Belgium, so I was familiar with the story, kind of, but to hear it from you firsthand is absolutely a pleasure. My question is, when I didn't see Kubrick by Candlelight yet, so my question is, did you consider filming on stock or did you otherwise try to emulate a 1970s look?
Yeah, I mean, we would have all loved, me and the DOP would have, loved to have filmed on, I suppose 60 mil is probably what we could have got hold of. But yeah, the expense of it, I think, would have really pushed us into a different, you know, landscape, and the time that takes and the lighting it takes. Now, obviously, what we wanted to do with Kubrick by Candlelight, given the title and the subject matter, was try and emulate John Alcott's amazing, world famous, legendary cinematography on a very small scale on an Arri Alexa. But of course, if Kubrick was making the film now, he could use an Arri Alexa and he could put a lighter in a dark room and you'd be able to shoot. But obviously those guys were having to light, you know, 400 triple wick candles and then hope for the best and get lenses that were designed by NASA in order to. So the bizarre thing now in when we shot in 2016-17 was that an Arri Alexa can do what those guys had to get NASA to help them. We could now just do on a, you know, almost a prosumer camera, which is bizarre, but yeah, so we definitely wanted to emulate it. What we didn't want to do, and this was kind of the note I gave the DOP still, was we wanted hot Lyndon. So Barry Lyndon's extremely beautiful, but it has a kind of coldness about it, which is what's obviously fantastic about it, a coldness of room, tone, people, emotions. And our film was meant to be, because it's behind the scenes, it's kind of hot Lyndon. It's kind of everyone's 70s and bright. But equally, we wanted to get that feel of the candle-lit rooms and those big windows and blown-out windows. So we had some big lights. And, you know, as much as you can ask Jan this, but in a few weeks' time, as much as everyone claims that all of it was shot by candlelight, it wasn't. They had lights. They did have lights outside windows. But it's, you know, it's a good marketing tool even then to say the whole thing was. But there, you know, there's certain scenes that were certainly candle lit, but they, if you read some of the articles in more detail, they definitely had lights. So we had lights too. We had candles, definitely. But yeah, it was a lot easier to work with an Arri Alexa and candlelight now. And then what we did is we had this fantastic then HD image, you know, beyond HD image, which was pin sharp. And then tragically, we went to the colorist and a Johnny Tully, who's a fantastic colorist that Still had worked with. And then we told him to destroy it, basically, to give it a kind of 70s blown out, fuzzy. So hopefully when you see the film, you'll think it's kind of a film that looks like it was shot in the 70s a bit. But we took a great looking image and then kind of slowly messed around with it, basically, to make it feel a bit more authentic to that the time that it was shot, rather than Barry Lyndon, if that makes sense. But we had some, you know, we've got some rooms that look like Barry Lyndon, and we had some big lights and we had lots of candles. I had a lot of candles in the boot of my car for about a year, and then one hot summer I went and looked in my boot and they'd all melted into one huge candle. Luckily I never had a fire in my car, because it would have looked fantastic. But hopefully when you see it, the cinematography is out of this world in terms of trying to copy John, but also give it a kind of a not carry on film, but kind of a warm hotness that isn't in Barry Lyndon. So it's kind of, it very much is behind the scenes. It's kind of warm color costumes and bright oranges and, you know, that kind of, and you'll see like Amy's hair kind of glows and stuff. And that's all still working with his lights, his great camera, but then Johnny Tully, the colorist, sort of punching up some highlights and, you know, kind of just giving it a glow to it, which you don't get when you shoot that Arri Alexa, because it's so pin sharp and beautiful. It's got almost no imperfections at all, but there's something kind of slightly disturbing about that kind of image where it's so clean and clear. So we took a very expensive HD camera and then destroyed the image. So So yeah, let me know when you see it what you think, how we got on with that.